The history of the old Slavonic language. In this video, I shall familiarize you and more closely explain the very history and development of the old Slavonic language since the ancient times and up to the modern era, as well as its official use within the Slavic Orthodox churches. The primary goal of this video is to inspire you to further discover this topic for yourself, because what is being taught today is not always correct in its entirety. In this documentary, I shall quote the authentic historical sources as well as evidence that includes the hagiographies of Cyril and Methodius that shall be of use to us as the actual accounts of that period in history. The Moravian Pannonia Mission. According to the official hagiography of Cyril, somewhere between the end of the year 862 or the beginning of the year 863, the great Moravian Duke Rastislav had sent an official envoy to the Roman Emperor Mikhail with the following message: "Our people have renounced the pagan ways and have stayed true to the Christian law, but we do not have a teacher that would explain the Christian faith in our language so that the other kingdoms would see that and thus follow our example. That is why I implore you, great emperor, to send us such a teacher and episcope." Chapter 14. There is also a similar passage within the hagiography of Methodius: "Through the grace of God we are in good health, and to us many a teacher had arrived, Christians from the lands of Romans and from Greeks, as well as from the Germans, teaching us differently. However, we, the Slavs, are humble people who do not possess a person that would guide us to the truth and who would rationally explain the truth to us. That is the reason why, our benevolent emperor, you should send us such a personage to justly instruct us." Chapter 5. There is no doubt that the Duke Rastislav had been coerced to perform such a bold step by the pressing matters of both state and politics. The independence and freedom of his duchy had been brought into question by the growing military as well as the political threat, constant warfare with Louis the German, but also the cultural and ecclesiastical pressure from the German clergy had been present. Because in those times political independence could only be achieved through the acquisition of the ecclesiastical independence by having your own lower and higher clergy. In Moravia at the time, Christianity had been spread by the Bavarian missionaries, and regarding the church jurisdiction, Moravia had fallen under the rule of the Passau diocese, or more precisely, it fell into the authority of the Salzburg Great Diocese, the very center of the missionary effort in the West. In that light, the magnitude of the designs created by the Duke Rastislav was completely understandable when he had implored the Roman Emperor to send him a teacher and an episcope who would convey to the Moravian people the essence of Christian faith in their own Slavonic language. The purpose was to free itself from the ecclesiastical dependence of the German church authorities, and this was only possible if the foreign clergy could be replaced by his own domestic clergy composed from Moravians. Meanwhile, in Constantinople, the petition of the Duke Rastislav had been perfectly understood and outright accepted. To Moravia, an episcope had not been sent, as the petition had sincerely requested, but a full religious and cultural mission of special magnificence and method of preaching had been both formed and dispatched, headed by the erudite and famous brothers Constantine the philosopher and the abbot Methodius, already experienced in the matters of this sort. According to the hagiography of Methodius, The Emperor Mikhail had justified his choice with the following words. Do you hear these words, philosopher? No other could perform this task save thee. Thus carry with thee many a gift. Take thine abbot, brother Methodius, and depart, because both of thee hail from Thessalonica, where the folk speakest pure Slavonic. Brothers Constantin, named after taking the monastic vows, Cyril and Methodius, were from Solun, the second most important Roman city in which at the time many Slavs had lived, especially within the suburban areas where the majority of the residents had been of Slavic origin. The older brother Methodius, born in circa 815, had been at first a high-ranking state official, the governor of the Slavic duchy, Slav-populated region in the Struma valley, but later he had retreated to the monastery, becoming an abbot in time. Younger brother Constantin had shown already in Solun his extraordinary penchant for science, thus being brought by the Empress Theodora to Constantinople, where he studied under the tutelage of the best professors together with the future Emperor Mikhail. Upon the completion of his studies, he had been appointed to the post of chartophylax, a librarian and an archivist, within the Constantinople church, but he had been soon summoned to teach philosophy at a grand school in the Constantinople, thus gaining the nickname philosopher, after a slight respite spent in the monastery. Prior to the mission in Moravia, Constantine had undertaken two missions of similar sort, the Arabian mission in Asia Minor among the Saracen populace, where he had successfully debated the religious topics with the Islamic scholars in the city of Samara. The second mission was a joint effort with Methodius undertaken in the region of Hazara, where Constantine had shown his multitude of talents that included the study of the Samaritan dialect and alphabet. During the brief period that the mission had spent in Chersonesus, performed en route to the kingdom of Hazarat, which had been formed in the region between the Black and Caspian Sea. During that brief respite in Chersonesus, Constantine had found the Gothic Gospel and Psalm written in the Russian alphabet, through which he had learned that language. Ultimately, it was also the place where he had found the remains of Saint Clement, the Roman Pope from the 1st century AD, which he will carry with him until he arrived in Rome. Before his departure for Moravia, Constantine had translated the ceremonial rites together with Methodius and his other assistants, as well as creating a separate alphabet for the old Slavonic language. We can find an account regarding the preparations within the hagiography of Cyril. The philosopher then left, and in accordance with his own old ways, he resorted to prayer alongside his assistants. He then created the letters and began composing a gospel. In the beginning there had been a word, and the word had hailed from God, and God had been the word, among others. Chapter 14. And there is also a passage in the hagiography of Methodius. Having adhered to the word from above, they had devoted themselves to the prayer alongside their kin. And here the God revealed unto the philosopher Slavonic books, and then, having created the letters and having composed the sermon, he departed for Moravia, bringing Methodius alongside him. Chapter 5. Highlighting the mentioned proclamation, Selishchev concludes the following. We could safely presume that Constantine had tackled the task of creating the Slavonic alphabet before his actual departure for Moravia. Within such a short period of time that had been given to Constantine before the Moravian mission, It was a truly tremendously demanding assignment conveyed to the philosopher to create an alphabet that would perfectly fit the peculiarities of the Slavic language system. Furthermore, a considerable amount of groundwork and preparation had been required for the translation and adjustment of the Slavic language and its elements so that it could perform a new task to become a literary language that could be utilized for reading the sacred ritual scriptures. That is why we can assume with great certainty that Constantine had already given thought as well as effort to create a compact system of Slavic literacy within the Roman Byzantine Empire, as well as for the neighboring Bulgaria. To this day, the reasons for such tardiness in the implementation of literacy for the Slavs had remained occluded. The Moravian mission that Constantine had been charged with had inspired him to resume his work of the creation of the literary language for Slavs. He had not altered the earlier linguistic base of that language, the base of the language he himself had known, the language of the Solun Slavs. Through an indirect contact with the members of the Moravian envoy, Constantine had been convinced that the language of the Solun Slavs had been fully comprehensible and available to the Moravians. Old Slavic Language 1, page 11. Equipped with the Slavic alphabet and having translated the most important of books, the brothers have arrived in Moravia in 863 or in 864 to conduct their mission. To them, several hand-picked students had been assigned to teach them the Slavic language and in the same time to introduce them into priesthood. Besides that assignment, the brothers have worked on the ushering of Slavonic liturgy as well as holy service and had worked incessantly on the organization of a national church system while attempting to translate as much religious scriptures as possible. From the very beginning of their devoted work, the brothers had faced open hostility from the German clergy that adhered to the Latin tradition, which had formally accused both Constantine and Methodius of heresy. The reason for this lies in the belief that in those times when speaking of literacy, especially in the Western Church, the only languages that had been allowed such a special privilege were Jewish, Greek, and Latin. But in reality, the work of the two brothers had been a direct threat to their influence and social standing. After 40 months of work and presence in Moravia, probably due to drive to attain an official sanctification from the Pope regarding the usage of Slavonic language in the church as well as finishing the clerical training of their students, the brothers, accompanied by their students, had left for Rome. According to the hagiography of Cyril, on that road he had been welcomed by Kocel, Duke of Pannonia, and having fallen in love with the Slavonic alphabet, he assigned 50 students to study it. Chapter 15. The warm welcome that the brothers and their students have received in Rome had been described in the hagiography of Cyril. The very elder of the apostles, Adrian, came forth himself with citizens holding candles. The Pope, after receiving the Slavonic books, consecrated them and sung the holy liturgy above them. Then the Pope had ordered the two episcopes, Formosus and Gauderic, to bless the Slavic students. During the blessing, they sang the liturgy on Slavonic language, and again, they sang the entirety of night service in Slavonic, glorifying the Lord. Chapter 17. Here in Rome, Constantine had fallen ill, retreating to the Greek monastery where he had entered priesthood and passed away as Cyril on the 14th of February 869. After Cyril's death, Methodius has not left Moravia straight away. Answering the summons of the Duke Kocel, he left for Pannonia in the same year of his brother's passing, after he had received a special letter from the Pope in which, according to the hagiography of Cyril, it is written the following. Adrian, an episcop and a humble servant of God, to Rastislav and to Svatopluk and to Kocel, we, after a lengthy deliberation, have decided to send unto thee Methodius, assigning several students to his care, to teach thee as thee hath implored through preaching from books written in thine language, like Constantine the philosopher had done before. However, just preserve this single custom during the Holy Mass, and that is to read the Apostle and the Gospels first on Latin, then on Slavonic. Chapter 8. Besides this letter, in the following year, 870, Methodius had become the archiepiscop of Pannonia and Moravia. However, this appointment had been met with extraordinary resistance by the German bishops in Salzburg and Passau, which had considered those territories to be under their rule and have done everything to prevent Methodius from taking the post. They had even utilized deceit to bring Methodius before their court in Bavaria only to imprison him in their dungeons for entire 3 years. Only after a direct intervention by the Pope John VIII, Methodius could be saved from imprisonment. As a result, he returned to Moravia in 874 only to witness a turbulent chain of events, where Rastislav had been overthrown by the very opponent of Slavic literacy, his own fraternal nephew Svatopluk, who in turn had been aided by the Germans. In addition, the official stance of Rome regarding the usage of Slavonic language in churches had been inconsistent and had frequently changed, thus forcing Methodius to travel to Rome and once to Constantinople. In the hagiography of Methodius, we can read the following. Out of his students, he had chosen 2 priests, 2 fastest scribes, and had tasked them with the translation of the entire holy book, save Maccabeus, from Greek into Slavonic. Because before that he had translated the Psalm and the Gospel with the Apostle and several chosen monastic services alongside the philosopher. Then he had translated the Nomocanon, or the Rule of Law, as well as the books of the forefathers. Chapter 15. Methodius had passed away on the 6th of April in the year of 885. On his deathbed, he had been asked by his students the following, according to the hagiography of Methodius. Who do you hold worthy among your students, our honorable father and teacher, to continue your work? Methodius had shown one of his most precious of students, known as Gorazd of Ohrid. Chapter 17. The fate of old Slavonic language and literacy after the death of Methodius. After the death of Methodius in Moravia, a dire fate had befallen the Slavonic holy service and literacy. Pope Stephen V had not acknowledged Gorazd as the heir of Methodius, thus appointing the German bishop Wiching, the most adamant opponent of Methodius, to the post of the archiepiscop of Moravia and Pannonia. To make matters worse, the Pope had forbid the usage of old Slavonic in churches. Wiching and the German party, under Svatopluk's blessing, began brutally and indiscriminately settling their score with the students of Cyril and Methodius. They are being imprisoned, savagely tortured, banished, and some even sold into slavery. However, the magnificent and just work of the Solun brethren Cyril and Methodius could not be vanquished by brute force. having been banished from Moravia, all known and unknown students of the two brothers had spread the idea and practice of Slavonic literacy to all corners of the Slavic world. The main center of Slavonic literacy had been established in Macedonia, on the shores of Ohrid Lake, where many banished students had continued the work under supervision of Clementus and Naum. Here an entire array of various monasteries and schools had been established, in which the teachings of Cyril and Methodius had been continued and preserved in both aspects of language and alphabet. Most of the glagolitic manuscripts that comprised the Slavonic canon had been created here, within the Ohrid and Macedonian schools of scribes. As far as the Czech is concerned, concludes Mieczysław Małecki, Najstarszy literacki język Słowian, page 21. The recent research had proven the fact that the Slavonic service must have been developed here to a considerable degree. From the second half of the 11th century, a series of excerpts from the Praska region had been preserved that are related to the monastery of the Glagolitic adherents in Sazava, who were extremely active in the 12th century. According to the hagiography of Methodius, Slavonic service had made its way to Poland, but unfortunately, no physical evidence had been preserved to verify the fact. The name of Old Slavonic language. In the oldest written evidence from the 9th and 10th century, Slavic, Greek as well as Latin, the Old Slavonic language had been known simply as Slavonic. From the Slavonic sources, within the hagiographies, we can discover the rule Slovenske, Jenzik Slovenski, Knjigi Slovenskien, Rostislav Knenz Slovensk, etc. In the Greek hagiography of Saint Clement, we can find the following, Ta Slovenica Grammata. In Latin sources, Lingua Sclavinica, Sclaviniska, Sclavina. In science, that name had not been accepted mainly because of two reasons from the very beginning. Because it is utterly vague, it can symbolize every Slavic language separately and all Slavic languages as a whole, because the same name had been used to refer to two separate Slavic languages, Slovenski jezik, Slovenian language, and Slovenski jazik, Slovakian. This erratic series of name changes had been in accordance with the frequent different interpretation of the Slavonic language's origins and size. The name had been designated to symbolize one of the following, to signify the territorial and tribal identity of the Old Slavonic language, or to highlight the character as well as the function of the Old Slavonic language. Based on the first assumption, the term Altbulgarische Sprache had emerged, Old Bulgarian language, coined by the German linguists Schleicher and Leskin, and this term is still only used by the Bulgarian linguists. The faulty assumptions behind this term are: Old Bulgarian could create a speculation regarding the language used by the old Turan or Turkish Bulgarians that had not mixed with the Slavs in the 9th century. It does not signify the Macedonian character of the Old Slavonic language, thus not providing the accurate picture of tribal identity of the language. It gives the false presumption that the contemporary Bulgarian language is the direct result of the development of the Old Bulgarian language. It cannot encompass all of the Old Slavonic scriptures. It does not provide definite proof of the written Slavonic language as well as its church variant. Based on the first assumption, another term had appeared, Altslovenische Sprache, Old Slovenian Language, Lingua Paleoslovenica. That term had been used by Miklošić all of his life. Today it had been completely abandoned because it gives a distorted image of the origin of the Old Slavonic language. Based on the second assumption, the term Old Church Slavonic had been introduced by Vondrak so that it could be used to mark the language of Old Slavonic monuments hailing from the 10th and the 11th centuries, the language of the monuments that comprise the so-known Old Slavonic canon. This term had been well accepted in the domain of science, among the Germans, Poles and others. The term Old Slavic, Staroslovensky, had been coined by Fortunatov and the rest of the Russian linguistic school. That is primarily a linguistic term that encompasses the oldest form of the Slavic languages. It includes all of the Old Slavonic texts of all colors and dialects, having a broad range of application. In Russian, Staroslavyansky Yezik. In Polish, język staroslowiański. Usage of the old basis of the term, the Czechs had created the following term, język staroslowiański. As we could see from this presentation, the term Old Slavic language could encompass the entirety of liturgical language from the 9th century up to the present. However, under the term Old Church Slavonic, only a single dialect of the language had been considered, the very one that had been developed in Russia after the initial texts had arrived from the school that was established by Cyril and Methodius. The differences between these two variants had been extremely small, but under the definition of the Old Slavic, we can consider everything that has, among other things, the nasal voices, such as the big and small U's. For example, we can use golomb instead of golub, or menso instead of miaso. Unfortunately, under the assault of the Turkish Ottoman Empire on Balkans and mostly Serbia, countless scriptures had been destroyed. However, answering the appeals of the church, from Russia a series of texts had arrived, but those had been already altered to suit the Russian dialect of the period. That was considered as the Russian reduction of the Old Slavonic language. The interesting thing regarding the matter of those texts is that the clergymen that had received those scriptures had tried to revert them to their initial state from the times of Cyril and Methodius, according to what they had known and remembered. This was known as the Serbian reduction of the Russian reduction of the Old Slavonic language. However, much later, to be precise, in the modern era, the Russian variant of the Old Slavonic had been accepted, known today as the Church Slavonic language, so that we could differentiate it from the first literary language of the brothers Cyril and Methodius. We can say for certain that the language known as the Church Slavonic is an integral stage of the evolutionary process of the Old Slavic language that lives to this day.